looks like everyone's kind of busy right now. It's not surprising. The synchronicities I've had a conversation today where it seems like parallel situations are happening for people. Just like amazing. I say, like, that's the same thing has happened to me. It's like not just one, there have been several people like this. It's just so extraordinary. We've gone through a very, very difficult time the past month, to say the least. And we talk about how we're bouncing back now. I reached low ebb a couple days ago, and I'm bouncing back, but my nerves are still on edge, to say the least. And I talked about how, or we talked about how our habits, our old bad habits, are trying to grab a hold of us, and it's real difficult to keep our good habits going. And I said, right now it's a great victory just to not backslide. This is what we want. The victory we want is don't backslide. And maybe just make little advancements in your habits, your good habits. It's very difficult to just, smooth sailing right now. There's a ferocious storm, and we're just kind of trying to ride it out. So just guard against backsliding, which is what I'm trying to do. It's been quite difficult, actually. I'm trying. I'm holding on. I'm holding on. I'm holding on here. As all these old bad habits are suddenly leaping up, trying to grab me. So maybe you're probably experiencing something similar. We're under this very extreme duress, actually. As you try to hold your mind in truth, you're finding there's ferocious winds and storms all about you, trying to get you angry, get you agitated, make you lash out, fatigue you, make you sleep deprived, all sorts of stressful things, maybe cause an accident for you. It's really intense right now. And it's not easy to tape because I'm not so freewheeling. I am at times, and then some really severe storms suddenly arise. And I wish they wouldn't, but they keep doing so. And it kind of gets my nerves, like, wow. But we're not without progress. The momentum continues. The momentum continues. And we have to stay on the positive side of it all, okay? The ego tries to get us to attack the ego. And that's, it loves attack. It understands attack. It doesn't understand love at all. Kindness and reason and love. It doesn't understand that. So it always tries to orchestrate stuff so we feel like we need to lash out and attack the ego, because then it says, ah, good, we can relate now. It's terrible, isn't it? It really is awful. And you said a lot of, usually you feel like there's no way I can relate because the ego's always structuring everything so that you, it feels like you have to attack. There's no way to get through to the ego. Of course there isn't. Which the ego is just a belief in that reality scripted, really. It's time, space, process, and form. The mother goddess, divine mother, is that belief in that reality scripted. And reality is perfectly free of scripts. There's only one God the Father. We call it the Father to make sure we don't fall into God the Mother trap of believing in scriptedness, which mothers identify with form. With the production of form, the feminine production of form. So we call it God the Father, but really it's just God the isness, God the isness, God the spontaneous isness of the now. Everything happens in the now. Everything is always fresh in the now. There's no script at all in reality, and this is becoming more and more and more clear to me. And yet it's so far removed from the ego's understanding. Anyone's understanding, actually. This is very simple and basic, and yet it seems that therefore it seems very advanced, because we're coming at the situation from a standpoint of belief in complexity, which means scriptedness. Non-scripted simply means there's nothing that needs, we have no need for anything to happen first or before we experience exactly what we desire to experience. Reality is that whatever we desire to experience is exactly what we're experiencing right now. And this is actually true even in this hideous nightmare we call the world. We're still experiencing exactly in the moment what we desire to experience. But we're making it such, making it seem like it's a script. So then we can say we can improve upon the script, which means we're trying to improve upon reality, which gets back to the original problem of us trying to be greater than God. And how do we do that? There's only one way, which is believing in that reality scripted. It's the only way. Otherwise, we'd realize that greater than God is meaningless. We're perfectly free to experience anything we want to experience. How can you be greater than that? We can't. It's not possible. So what we do is we believe in that reality is scripted, which means one moment is bound to another. I mean, if we wanted to experience moment B or A, let's say moment A, first we have to experience moment B because moment B comes before moment A, and they're bound together. This is called scriptedness, and there is no scriptedness in reality at all. There's none. Zero. This is what we most have not yet gotten to, and I'm getting to it now, very, very much so. That whole door is opening up. It's all opening up for me. But this causes great backlash in the world. This is what the world fears, thinking that unscriptedness is chaos. It's just the opposite. It's complete lack of chaos, the impossibility of chaos, actually. And since we are desiring to improve upon God, we don't want perfection. We want to believe reality isn't perfect, so then we can improve upon it. That's all. It's all this terrible scriptedness. So we can make a better script and say, "Aha, we're greater than God." This is our little silly, stupid, silly game that we're so tired of. Okay, so everything is instantaneous, spontaneous. Longchenpa said that what he most desires for us is that we all realize and accept this inherent spontaneity of reality. He's completely aware of this. All of our four root Dharma kings abide in the total realization that reality is completely unscripted. Okay, all four of them do. And I have investigated this very carefully. That's why I feel so compatible with all four of Jesus, Longchenpa, Ram Maharshi, Sri Sri Anandamayi. All four of them, for sure, are completely aware and accepting and know that reality is entirely unscripted. Now, Jesus, in A Course in Miracles, he said, an article by Dr. Brent Haskell that he said that the script is written. But understand the context. That's the Holy Spirit. It's the illusion that removes all illusion. So that's the context. But reality is not scripted at all. Okay, just we have this illusion that it is scripted. So the Holy Spirit has a quote-unquote script to free us from the belief in script, and then once we're free of that, the Holy Spirit then just remains to bless the unscriptedness of reality. Reality is entirely unscripted, it meaning totally free. Whatever we order is on our plate instantly, and nothing other than that. And nothing we have to have first. It's not like we order scrambled eggs or whatever we order. Pizza, let's say pizza, say, oh, you want pizza? Okay, but first, you know, you have to eat the French fries. So wait a minute, no, I just want to eat pizza. No, the first, this is the sequence, this is the script, first the French fries, then the pizza. No, in reality, you order pizza, and there's the pizza. There's nothing intervening, and there's no need for any intervention, actually, in reality. However, in our state of severe delusion, where we have believed that unscriptedness is chaos, which is crazy. I mean, consider this. Don't think about it, but just obviously realize if everyone is getting exactly what they want, isn't that perfection? Isn't that perfect harmony, perfection? How could there be chaos? That's the opposite of chaos. Chaos is when nobody's getting what they want. I don't know. I'm trying to find it. I can't find it. You know, it's chaotic. I don't know where to look. I'm lost. That's where nobody's getting what they really want, which is this dream is really a dream of chaos. Whereas reality, everybody's getting exactly what they order, which is perfect. That is perfect order. Perfect orderliness is when everyone gets exactly what they order. Of course. Of course. So it's not chaos at all. It's the dream of scriptedness that's chaos, because then nobody's getting what they really want. So they're always looking for excuses and somewhere else, and their mind is chaotic. So we've had it upside down and backwards, to say the least, about all of this. Now, in prayers for help, as we are being assaulted by this spiritual materialism, the belief in scriptedness, then we just need to make a divine script of it all. Whereas, and really, we need to be aware that everything is actually fundamentally, completely unscripted. We don't want to say there's a script and then try to spiritualize the script. This is madness. So, we're being assaulted by this spiritual materialism. It's very intimidating and ferocious in its demands. So we need some protection. There are spiritual protectors. Spiritual protection, as the Dharma kings, are spiritual protectors who protect our momentum towards the acceptance of the unscripted, spontaneous nature of reality. The instantaneous, spontaneous, non-scripted nature of reality, of absolute freedom. We have momentum towards accepting this, but we continually are being, you know, huge waves are sent our way of belief in scriptedness. You know, an illness here, a sickness here, as if, oh, it's inevitable. I all day long, that's all I get now in the world, is people's attitudes, most people. It's just, wow. You know, there's nothing we can do. You know, we're just human animals, and we just this belief in scriptedness. We're not. We're divine, formless spirit, completely free, completely divine, and completely served by the living light that serves us up whatever we order instantaneously in the now, never having to wait one instant for this. So time doesn't exist at all. It's just a figment of our imagination, actually. We think of time as waiting for, you know, for some script to play out. There's no script playing out, actually. We're just believing that there's a script playing out, but there's never a script playing out. Only our freedom is at play. This is always the case. Now, very interesting. Everything that's happening, the synchronicities, the stories I could tell you, but for the sake of time, I'll just acknowledge it. Maybe you're having a lot of synchronicities too. And very symbolic stuff playing out. Very symbolic. The Trinity, I remember the meeting with this divine figure. I thought it was Jesus. It may have been Jesus. It was this divine brother, you know, really. And I asked him about How many in the band? Yeah, you know, I was talking about like a musical thing. Like, how many in the band, a spiritual band playing the truth? And four, I said it. Four. He said three. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit is the Trinity. There's no fourth. There has been a tacit inclusion in Christianity, especially Catholicism, of the fourth, which is the Mother Goddess, which is really scriptedness. That's what they're really talking about. Scriptedness, believing that the script is the fourth part of reality, and this is not. That's the ego, okay. And the ego is not part of. There is no scripting. It's never taken place. It doesn't exist. And this is what this when my talking with this divine being. They were very insistent upon this. I was quite surprised. And they just said, no, it's very simple, just three, not four. No, Three sufficient. I don't need a fourth. As far as so scriptedness is not part of reality at all. It's not part of reality. It's just a dream that we're having. It's an imaginary, wishful thinking on our part. No two moments are joined together whatsoever. Never. Has never happened and never will be. So there is no quote-unquote mother of God. Is not, does not exist. Mother of God refers to the belief in scriptedness. That God can be given a script, a form. This is not true. Absolutely not true. So this is what we're trying to overcome. This false belief that we've had. It's very powerfully ingrained within us, which and those who believe in scriptedness are very, very much fanatical about it, thinking that without scriptedness we'd fall into some void. Just the opposite. We'd fall into the splendor of our experiencing. Complete lack of any void. If we get exactly what we order every instant, without any, then how could there be a void in our experiencing? It's impossible. Only the belief in time gives rise to the belief in avoidanceness, right? There's no avoidanceness in reality at all. It's impossible. So, I just considered before I start taping here, hey, I'm really getting assaulted by negativity by those who believe in scriptedness. It's just awful. This is the real division in the world. And I've never believed in scriptedness, actually. But trying to explain this to the world has been just incredibly difficult. The ones who have brought forth this truth are our four great teachers, our four great Dharma kings. I call Ananda my Dharma king, so I don't have to keep, going back and forth, Dharma king, queen of this. Dharma kings means spiritual protectors. Protectors of our spiritual momentum. And we need our minds to be protected at this time. We really do. And in that dream, this terrible storm came up, and this tabletop was put over me and protected me from this terrible rain of error, black and white granite. Wow. It's getting ferocious right now. So we can give permission for our mind to be protected at this time, actually. I've already given permission to any or all the Dharma kings you want to. Holy Spirit is the origin of all grace. Well, God's the origin of the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit then pragmatically is the origin of all pragmatic grace. And this pragmatic grace then emanates as Dharma kings that helps us relate to the grace, eases our acceptance of it. So we ask these Dharma kings to protect our minds. And it's important when you pray the Dharma kings, listen to this, very important. Don't say, can you do this for me? That's how I usually start out. And I say, no, that's stupid. Why am I saying, can they? It's ridiculous. Of course they can. That's really an insult. That can you do this? You're asking, I'm not really sure you have the capability of doing this. Well, of course they have the capability of doing it. So I say, will you do this for me? And that's a little better. Will you do this for me? And then I thought, well, of course they will do it for me. That's their job, their business. They'd love to do it for me. Getting odd smells in the air here. Wow. Keeps changing. Interesting. And so, there, it changed again. So I said, will you do it for me? Then I said, no, wait a minute, no. You've already done it for me. Thank you so much. Thank you for what you've already done for me. wow. The only thing is, I just haven't accepted it yet, because of my still weren't believing in scriptedness, time. So there's a delay, but you've already done it. So this is the kind of attitude we need to have. It's a done deal already. Soon as we give them permission to protect our minds, it's already done. Now, you might think, well, how come I haven't experienced it yet? Well, there's that little delay, but also we probably haven't asked. We probably haven't accepted. I've always said, can you help me? Can you help me do this? So that's not really asking them to protect our mind. It's asking, can you help me protect my mind? Like, I want to do it. Can you give me some pointers in doing this? That's a whole different thing, isn't it? Whereas I'm saying is, no, I'm not going to do it right now. I'm not able to. But you do it for me right now. You're a proxy, like a trustee of my mind. So you do it. You protect my mind, and I'll accept what you do. I have that faith and trust in you. This is a whole different thing. It's not like they're helping me. No, I'm letting them. I'm allowing them to protect my mind. So very different emphasis here. And when you do that, it's a done deal. It's already a done deal. It's already happened. And I'm asking them, you know, can you help me? No, it's a done deal. They've already done it. They've already liberated us, actually. They've already protected and liberated us. It's already a done deal. So this is called faith. This is true faith. That all religious traditions teach some sort of faith. And it's very important. This is real faith. Is have faith and believe that it's already accomplished. As soon as you put it in their hands, it's already done. It's when we try to share responsibility and say, well, I'll do it, some of it. You know, I'm going to do most of it, and you can help me a little bit maybe, or can you kind of advise me or something? Then that's trouble. I don't know where that... I don't know where that smell is coming from. Maybe stale water in the vase, probably. Yeah, that's probably it. It's already done. It's already done. It's already done. A lot of little insects flying around. It's already done. It's already done. It's a done deal. It's already a done deal. So just rely on that and don't worry anymore. And just be grateful. The most powerful prayer is just one of gratitude that your prayers have already been answered. Okay, this is the real way to pray. Because we're acknowledging their absolute dominion over any notion of scriptedness. Okay, they don't have to go through any script at all. They know they're not protecting any script, okay? These Dharma kings are not protecting any belief in any script at all, actually. None. So nothing trips them up. We try to champion our scriptedness as if it's being produced by some dynamic outside of our minds, so we have no control over it. So you say, well, you know, my life's being scripted and I have no control over it. And it's coming from some external dynamic. And we try to deify it, and, you know, but there's no such entity whatsoever, actually. We want to say there's a mother goddess who's doing all the scripting. There is no mother goddess and there is no scripting taking place. None. But we don't want to admit that we're just wishfully thinking this, okay, imagining it, wishful imagining, which means it's there is no scripting, which means reality is perfect, which means we can't improve upon reality at all, which means we can't usurp the place of God. So in order to avoid this recognition, we claim that there's some force that is scripting nature, scripting this, you know, we call it God, but we really mean some force outside of God doing this. Because God is unscripted. It's for absolute freedom. So to say that there's something scripting freedom into script time, space, process, and form is claiming there's something outside of God doing this, because God doesn't do that. Okay, and we can call it God, we can call it Goddess, all right? Well, we call it Father, we call it Mother, we call whatever we try to make it sound like it's, you know, some real dynamic, but there's such a dynamic doesn't exist at all, has never existed, never will. That's the void, you know, the void of believing in something that doesn't exist. That's the void, really. We're like living in a void. We believe we're living in a void. I guess we're afraid to see, oh, that's all a void. But it's just an avoidance of reality, isn't it? Or attempt to, but we can't avoid reality. It's we're always in the now. Everything's in the now. There's only the now. Now, our job is to enter into the protection, enter into the mental refuge. And this mental refuge may have an external counterpart to a reduced intensity zone. It may very well. Okay. People talk about the rapture or whatever. It's likely just a shifting or moving into a reduced intensity zone where it's much clearer that reality is not scripted, where the whole belief in scriptedness is greatly reduced. There's still some echoes of it, right? But we start to get more and more familiar with, hey, I don't really have to go off of any script. It's interesting when I'm singing, practicing singing along with songs, when I'm kind of feeling down spiritually, I'll just match the singing and sing what they're singing. But when I get into grace is flowing and I'm really accepting it, suddenly I go off script. You have this idea that I'm supposed to sing just exactly how the singer's singing the song. I say, well, wait a minute. No. I'm free to sing whatever I want to sing. And so I'll be very super creative then. And it's like, wow, that's real singing there. Love it. I love it. Spontaneous, very spontaneous in the now. And I can sing whatever I want to sing. Nothing telling me I have to sing the same notes or anything like that. Become very playful. So we're naturally very playful and creative when we're not scripted. This is our natural being. And the notion that we have to adhere to some script is completely unnatural to us. Totally bizarre. And we're just, of course, faking it, pretending it. Just all pretense. This is all pretense. Scriptedness is not happening. We're pretending that it's happening. By having terrible things happen to us, we say, oh, I couldn't script. I would never script that. Oh, look at this devastating illness, you know. You're crazy. You think I would script that. No, of course we would script it. We would pretend this so we could claim it must be script. It must be something else is scripting this. Or, meaning, I would never pretend this. Okay, so it must be scripted. This is what they're saying. I could never pretend this illness. Therefore, some dynamic has to be scripting it for me. Okay, do you get that? Whereas if we're experiencing bliss, we might say, well, yeah, this is exactly what I would ask for. When you're feeling your best, isn't it? Don't you say, you know, this just feels exactly what I would really want and ask for. And so it's easy to feel like, well, that is what you're asking for. And then you're directly experiencing it, so there's no scripting to it. But if we want to believe in reality scripted, we have to then believe in death and suffering and all this stuff. We say, oh, I would never ask for that. So something must be scripting it for me. This is the price we pay is suffering and fear. Of course, the belief that reality scripted is fearful because we were really believing in a void and chaos. Yes, we really are. Because reality seems to have disappeared. You know, we don't see it anymore. We don't see the now anymore. So just the notion came. I asked Longchamp, prayed to Longchamp for help. I seem to be Right now, he seems to be, Johnny on the spot. Okay? This is what I have discovered. I also discovered that Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma is like they call her the spiritual quote unquote mother, and she insisted she wasn't any mother, but there's, in a sense, you could say that she's like the nest where non-dual belief, non-dual acceptance is born. When I first saw her, I said, "Ah, wow! This it is possible. We can walk this world in true non-dual, in true unscripted fashion." Because she did that. We heard Jesus did it. We hear these legendary figures did it. Historical figures, but epic figures. But here is actual video and pictures of video of someone who actually did it. And so I saw a video where I was just absolutely went into the biggest wow, imaginable. And I said, I couldn't believe my eyes. I said, here is someone who's literally here in this world who doesn't believe in scriptedness at all and is functioning just fine, actually. Was like, wow. So that was like the birth of my confidence, of this higher confidence. So she gave birth to like a mother, and then I was in her nest for a while. And what happened was, I didn't want to leave the nest. I said, no, I'll just focus on you. You're good enough. You're all I need. But in her wisdom, she said, no. You need to leave this nest. You need to find out about more about Jesus, more about Rama Maharshi, more about Longchenpa. You need to really, really be very well acquainted with these other Dharma kings, and toughen up and strengthen up and broaden your horizons and get a bigger context and picture. So she kicked me out of the nest. She kicked me out of the nest. And so that's why I've been very upset about that. It's like, it's brutal. I said, brutal. But it was necessary. It was necessary, so I could understand how religions try to script reality. They tend to script reality. And I said, no, they got it wrong. As Longchenpa said, graduated endeavor just makes it worse. Because you keep trying to script everything. It's a trap. Now, so he's adamant about pointing out this dynamic of this trap. And you can see how religions script, subtly script, believe in that reality is scripted somehow. And when in fact it isn't. And you also, though, can realize that these great Dharma kings taught that it's totally unscripted, reality is totally unscripted. And yet, that who they were speaking to didn't believe it. They said, well, you must mean that, some of it's unscripted, but some of it must be scripted. I mean, look at this world. No, there is no world. People say there's a world. There's no world. Like Punjaji said, nothing has ever happened, which is a very profound statement. I very much love Punjaji. I don't put him as one of our Dharma kings, but that doesn't make him any less. He was a very, very beautiful non-dual presence, really. And saying nothing has ever happened is absolutely true. I wish I would have met him, actually. I really do. He's a direct disciple, devotee of Rama Maharshi, actually. Nothing has ever happened, meaning nothing has ever been scripted. There is no world. There's never been a world. There's no mother goddess giving birth to worlds and cosmoses. No. No such thing exists. No such dynamic exists. That's just wishful thinking, that there's some dynamic that scripts. There's no dynamic that scripts anything. Okay? The Holy Spirit gives the illusion of scriptedness to lead us out of the belief in scriptedness, but there's not really any scriptedness taking place, actually. There's no real dynamic, and nothing is really being scripted at all. We never have lost our freedom. Nothing ever has. There's not like some freedom and then some scriptedness. Not at all. So this whole thing about saying, father, mother, God, goddess, all this stuff, is nonsense. There's only one prime creator. Now, you can make a neutral gender if you want. That's fine. Just it or isness, the one isness. But there's not ever two-ness at all in reality. There's no scriptedness. Two-ness always implies scriptedness. That's duality. There's no God goddess. There's no mother of God. There's no mother of God whatsoever. Okay? There's no scriptedness in reality. None. Zero. Doesn't exist. And we think, well, that's a void. No. It's a complete fullness of whatever we want to experience instantly being presented to us. It's the opposite of a void. We're engaged, one's engaged in avoidance. In a voidance. By believing that there's a script, that the moments are not free. The demigods and goddesses are back in this world. All the different realms of this delusion of conditioned existence, of scriptedness, are commingling in this world right now. And the demigods, of course, what else can they do except say that they're greater than God, that they're here to present a better script, to say, oh yeah, this script here, it's not as good, I can make a better script. And I just have to burst out laughing at this. I just burst out laughing. Is when you see the demigods and goddesses realizing what they're about, what else can they do? Claim they're greater than God. Of course, that's what they claim. And they say that let's make a better world. I'll help you, script it, make the script better. It's hilarious when you see it as it is. Really, it's quite hilarious. You can't help but burst out laughing. And laughter is from the unscriptedness. It's the reaction we have in this world to realizing unscriptedness tends to be laughter. Children tend to laugh a lot as they drop their silly little game. One little imagination, they go to another one, they laugh. It's all just fun. Oh, this is funny. I can just imagine this, then change and imagine this and change. It's all unscripted. Nothing is really, I can make, whatever this symbolizes something for my game, and then I'm going to change it. Okay, now it symbolizes this. They can take a rock and imagine it's anything at all. All right? The rock is now a house. The rock is now a baseball. The rock is now a watermelon. The rock is now a hat. Anything. To them, there's nothing that is really scripted at all. And so laughter, bursting out in laughter, laughter is the response to seeing it the way it really is, as Longchenpa and Jesus have pointed out. And Anandamayi often would burst out in divine laughter. And she said that we must go beyond good consciousness and bad consciousness and just be saturated in the isness. Just allow the isness, the realization that permeates everything, the isness permeates. There's no such thing as good scripting and bad scripting. Consciousness means scripting. It tends to mean scripting. There's no script. So you have to go beyond the good scripting as well as the bad scripting. So the demigods and goddesses are claiming they're coming here to spiritualize the world by giving us this good scripting. This is, of course, ludicrous duality. Now, can Longchenpa, for instance, protect our mind? Not can he? Will he? Not will he. He already has. So take it this way. He's already done it. And then from that point, then just feel gratitude. You see how that prayer just goes quickly to gratitude. You feel, wow. And then this gratitude puts you in the wow, doesn't it? Like, wow, he's already done it. Wow. And so you're getting used to the fact he's already done it, which what does that do? Evaporates our belief in time. Evaporates our belief in process. Evaporates our continuity fear. This is how we make time disappear, is the gratitude for what's already accomplished. You see that? So we're not struggling thinking, how do I get Longchenpa to help me? No. We abandon that entirely. And we just say, it's already done. He's already done it. Here's the present. I already have it in my hands, as a matter of fact. I just need to look at it. It's already here. All I need to do is look at it. And then I'm protected. It's like he's already opened the door. All I have to do is just recognize, see this, recognize it. And so gratitude, again, we feel gratitude for it. What's already accomplished for us. The grace is already accomplished for us. And for everyone, really. But those who ask for it, it seems the awareness comes sooner because we're accepting that it's already done, you see. The others are saying, well, you know, it's scripted, so I have to wait for the script to play out. Whereas we're saying no script needs to play out. It's done this instant. The instant we ask for it, it's done. So now we're just grateful, which tunes us into what we already have, doesn't it? Doesn't that, if we see someone buys us a car, it's in the driveway, aren't we grateful and saying, oh, wow, we feel this great gratitude. This is how we get used to what we have, is gratitude. So we need to have gratitude. I mean, you don't have gratitude for what you don't have, right? You're still trying to get it. You're thinking, how do I get this? How do I get this? But when you've got it, it's like, oh, great, I've got it. I feel so grateful. This is really great. So I feel grateful. So when we feel grateful, we're reminding ourselves we already have it. See that? This is the true power of prayer. We already have it. Cast aside all worry and fear and concern, because those are all beliefs in scriptedness and time. Time doesn't exist. Figment of our imagination, a belief there's some dynamic that is somehow scripting reality. There is no such dynamic. None. Doesn't exist. Time does not exist. Process does not exist. Form does not really exist. And space as part of a scriptedness does not exist. There is no, again, mother of God that is scripting God. God is not scripted. These are all fantasies that we have in our attempt to be greater than God. So we're grateful for what we already have, which is here right now. I met somebody. We're talking about happiness, and he says, you know, I'm most happy when I just accept everything as it is. Wow. Also, somebody else telling me they're leaving in 3 days for Southern California. Wow. So, actually, a couple people. One has left today, and the other's leaving 3 days. They're quitting their job here and moving back to Southern California. It's like, all this stuff is impacts me. Like, this is very profound. That's May 17th, isn't it? I think, is it not? Some people have put the rapture May 17th, but there may be some sort of Southern California. For me, it always implies unscriptedness, even though the movie industry is there, which is, you know, total scriptedness. In Northern California, they're very into scriptedness. Now, keep in mind that the whole technological invasion here is an invasion of scriptedness, of more intense scriptedness, belief in scriptedness, that we can script everything. But so their remedy is not to drop the belief in scriptedness, but to give more scriptedness, more cowbell to the whole thing. Say, let's script everything. So the danger we're in is machines, robotics, scriptedness, computers, chips, all this software, all this. We're basically the world is being run by these automatic scripts now. And we may find that out very soon, that the machines are actually in control now. 2001 Space Odyssey. HAL is now in control. Or maybe HALA is in control. You complain and HALA answers. Nice, pleasant female voice saying, "It's okay. We have now more advanced scripts for you. Your life is going to be much happier now. These scripts are automatic. There's no possibility of them failing. It's a blessing for you." HALA speaks. No, it's not a blessing, HALA, and you don't really exist at all. So we've had all these scripts thrown at us here in the world, but now it's unprecedented. It's times, you know, exponentially times like a trillion. This is the danger. We're under severe danger. And again, I said July 24th. The Holy Spirit told me July 24th, which is the historical date of all the most terrible sorrows in Jewish history. Interestingly enough, I didn't know that when this date, I was given this date. The walls of Jerusalem breached by the barbarians. The barbarians are those who believe in scriptedness, actually. And those are the ones programming the entire world of I was getting my vehicle smogged, and the guy said, you know, I can't work late anymore. I said, why? He says, all the machines shut down at 6 o'clock. You can't smog after 6 o'clock. If they do, they flag you for after-hours smogging, and if you get enough points against you, they'll come after you. Take your livelihood machines away from you and prosecute you. I said, wow. He says, yeah. He says, they're now monitoring everything, he says. This is a guy that has to deal with this remote monitoring. All his machines in the shop automatically shut down. You see? So we don't yet realize to what extent the world has been given over to these automatic scripts called software. But we're about to find out. And I have a much keener appreciation of the danger we're in. Scriptedness is just a habit, a belief that we have to break. So it's not a good thing to cultivate bad habits. All the habits we cultivate, we're going to have to break them. As Rama Maharshi said, everything we've learned, eventually we'll have to forget it. Meaning all belief in scriptedness, we'll have to forget it. Because what is learning except focusing on the belief in scriptedness? There's no reality, there's no need for learning at all. So you better be very careful about what habits you cultivate, because you're going to have to break those habits eventually. Which is why I've warned against all sorts of bad habits that I say, look, stay away from them. So this, all this sophisticated scriptedness is really the devil in disguise. The devil of conceit, devil of arrogance, belief we can be greater than God. Denial of our freedom from any scriptedness at all. How can freedom be scripted? That's not absolute freedom at all. That's counterfeit, fake. It's not true. So, we are going to be the machines are in control, really. They're in control. Those in the know already are aware of this. This is just our own desire to play with the idea of scriptedness to a much greater extent. Call it the fourth dimension, call it whatever you want, but this is the trouble. You don't want to go to the fourth dimension. You want to go to the fifth, meaning a place of reduced intensity of scriptedness, of belief in scriptedness. There's no technology there in the fifth dimension at all. Really, probably not any buildings or it's an experience where much more free-flowingness and spontaneousness. And sometimes we get the feeling of that here. Like when I was singing a couple of days ago, I was like, I was singing the way I can really sing. And it's like, it was way better than the, what the song was, because it was so creative and playful and evocative, and just, it was like living, as rather than just some dead script I was going through. I could veer off any which direction. I felt like in the now, just I can just veer any which way, really, and I could. I feel like veering here. So like when I was growing up playing music, I didn't play songs. I just jammed. I didn't like anything that was scripted at all. So I couldn't really be in a band because I wouldn't play scripted songs, really. I said, that's just dead. That's dead, you know. I want to play it this way. No, you got to play it like the people want it. You got to play it so the people can think, oh, you're playing the song. Yeah, they know. I said, no, I wouldn't do it. Then when the goddess of scriptedness got a hold of me, she said, no, you got to learn all these songs. I ended up learning thousands and thousands of songs. She's trying to teach me, no, you just have to do good scriptedness. That's what the thing is, which is a total lie. It's a total lie, actually. So we can be making progress on the spiritual path, and still our loyalty to scriptedness still bites us very badly, you see. So I can still play a song or sing a song, but I might just stop. I say, I don't really feel like finishing the song right this moment. Or I could hold a note much longer, or change the tempo or shift. Just anything. Just completely deliver it in a more unscripted manner, which, those who want to just hear the script, I want to see how well you can adhere to the script, they'll say boo, boo, too, terrible. But those who want to realize that they're not bound by script, they're going to say, this is music to my ears. Here's somebody who doesn't feel that they're imprisoned by any script, even this beautiful song, they're not imprisoned by. Spanish conquest of the Americas, after the reconquista of Spain from the Moors and the Muslims, they were bringing a script. They said, "Hey, we have a better script than your script. This is how we're gonna script you this way. This is the script you follow." And they're very vicious. They conquered under the banner of Virgin Mary. The Virgin Mary was the warrior goddess who protected and enabled them to massacre the people of the Americas. And that's the banner that they flew. And it's interesting, in the Americas, you would talk to the people back then, and the missionaries would come over eventually. And the people of the Americas who had been subject to the Spanish conquest, they only worshipped the Virgin Mary. They didn't know any other thing. All religion was the Virgin Mary, just the Mother Goddess. That's all there was. They didn't know anything about Jesus. Because the Spanish didn't bring Jesus along hardly at all. It was all the Virgin Mary, the warrior goddess, which is what? Scriptedness. Scriptedness. The goddess is scriptedness. The belief in scriptedness, which is Jesus calls it the ego. And to this day, I've directly experienced this. It was very scary. I've told the story before, but the bottom line is, they didn't know Jesus at all. They're from the jungles of Guatemala, some of the Yucatan jungles people, and it was all, the Mother Goddess. That's all they knew. She was everything to them. Fertility goddess, goddess of sacrifice, goddess of war, conquest, victory, this. It was all, which is just belief in scriptedness is all it is. And here I was trying to teach Jesus, and they had no idea what I was talking about, but they considered themselves Christians, which is absurd. A real Christian, as the song goes, a real true Christian won't go to hell, meaning hell is the belief in scriptedness. A real Christian follows Jesus Christ, which means unscriptedness. That Not that they've undone any script, but that there's never been any script, which is why monophysitism is true. Jesus was never human. Okay, there's no such thing as humanness, actually. Never has been any humans at all, because that's the belief that there's some script form. Form doesn't exist. In fact, there's never been any form. There's never been any process. There's never been any form. There's never been any world. Jesus was not human. There's only the divine. There's no such thing. There's nothing other than that. So it's impossible. The idea that God became human is absolute nonsense. That's the ego's belief. It's the ego's belief. God is always God, which is unscripted, pure freedom. So I know that there's those who, you know, it's like shocking to hear this, you know, but I didn't come here to pander to the ego. Okay, I came here to tell the truth, to serve Jesus Christ and the Dharma kings, which is, you speak the truth, you're serving all Dharma kings, okay? Because they all know that there's no such thing as script in this at all. No such thing. Doesn't, never existed. They all know this. So I'm here to serve the Dharma kings, to speak the truth. That's why they call me a Dharma prince. I speak the truth here. There's never been a world, okay? Never been human beings. There's no mother of God. There's So we've been through some very brutal, hideous stuff. I mean, Spanish conquest was just, and they just glorify, you know, Virgin Mary as the one that enabled them to carry out these treacherous massacres, who set the whole thing up. And she's riding with them in battle, to, you know, massacring, you know, people and directing every sword thrust to kill the enemy. This is just the belief in the Mother Goddess, Mother of God, belief in scriptedness. And they say, this is all scripted. We're the chosen people of God here. The Spanish at that time believed they were the chosen people of God to bring the gospel of what? Of their script, of their religion, the belief in scriptedness. They call it scripture, scriptedness, that everything is scripted. And they, well, that's the Antichrist, actually. That's the ego. So I guess they're the chosen ones of the ego at that time. And the repercussions are still there in a lot of places in the world, where the Virgin Mary is pretty much all the people know, and that's just a symbol of the belief in the ego, scriptedness, actually. That's how they take it. Most definitely they do. And they pray to her. They don't pray to Jesus. Not much, actually. Because they say, Jesus doesn't quite understand, because they think, you know, Jesus... It feels sort of unscripted to them. They say, but the mother, she really understands. She really believes in the flesh, you know. Being a mother, she understands that giving birth to flesh and, you know, that really there is this process and there is this form and there is this scriptedness, and she understands. Of course, we have a very strong tendency to identify scriptedness with the feminine, with the mother, because that's how we've imagined it. So that's why it's a very dangerous thing to try to refer to God as the mother, God the mother. Very slippery slope, to say the least. And it's not indicated at all. And even Sri Sri Narayana always used the masculine term, almost always, for God. He, Father, you know, He. She didn't refer to it in a feminine way at all. Same with Jesus. Same with all these teachers. Because at all costs, you have to avoid insinuating that there's any scriptedness to reality whatsoever. And anytime you use the feminine form to refer to God and reality, there's a heavy, heavy inference of scriptedness. Heavy, almost unavoidable. Yeah, it's obviously, right? Whereas the inference when you use a masculine pronoun is less pronounced. There's still some inference, but it's way less pronounced, and it might be better. The Buddhists don't even use gender really hardly at all. Just, you know, pure spaciousness. that really is much less inference of scriptedness, isn't it? So when you're starting to go beyond the belief in scriptedness, the great Tibetan adept, Dharma King Lekalan Chempa, is very helpful. because we want to get free of any association with any inference of scriptedness, really. It's very helpful, very helpful. I find it very helpful. When I'm trying to, to put it in Christian terms, I feel like I'm hitting my head against a wall. It's just a wall of history. It's been some very, very nasty business take place throughout the history of Christianity in terms of egoic projections and belief in scriptedness and all this. Tibetans seem to have a much cleaner history in terms of keeping it real. So it's not really encumbered with this male-female dichotomy thing so much. It's more based on just pure spaciousness, isness, nowness, the pure spontaneity of the now. Sogchen's all about that, the pure spontaneity of the now. And that's all there is. There isn't any scriptedness. There's no process. So there's no mother giving birth to anything at all. Nothing has ever been born. Born basically insinuates process, a script, right? Everything is actually unborn in its nature. This Buddhism sometimes called this as emptiness. There's only emptiness. I mean, there's only unbornness. Nothing has ever been born. As Advaitins might say that, nothing has ever been born. It's absolutely true. We live in an unborn world. An unworld. An unborn world. That's not a void at all. It's just there's no bornness to it. That doesn't mean it's a void. Everything is still present, but it's fresh, completely fresh in the moment, and not tied to any other moment, unscripted, entirely unscripted, actually. Now, we can continue to see it the way we see it. That doesn't mean it's scripted. No, it's all in the now. We're free to veer off. Just like, for instance, I'm listening to a song and singing with it. And sometimes I say, you know what, the way that they're singing that song is just really great. I love it. So I just feel like singing it the same way they're singing it. Yeah, I'll feel that way. And I'll sing it the exact same way. Because this is how I feel. And there are other times I feel like improvising. And harmonizing, improvising. But I still stay within the framework of the song, so to speak. Why not? That's fun. So you can still recognize the song, but there's a lot of improvisation and playfulness and creativity going on. Singing it a different way, but it still blends with what's being sung. So just as we see the world's unborn doesn't mean we can't keep singing the song of an unborn world. No, of course we can. And we might just sing it, just play it straight, just the same way, it's the song is being sung. Or we might improvise a little bit. Throw a few miracles in there and laugh a bit. And sure, we could do that. But Rama Maharshi, Sri Sri Nandamayama, they handled their stuff, didn't they? I mean, they functioned beautifully here. They improvised. Sometimes they sang it just the way we wanted to hear it. Other times they improvised. It was like somebody called for help. Oh, Nandamayama's she's 1,000 miles away, and she's also in this room. Bi-locate, or tri-locate, or however many locations it wants to be at the same time. And no problem. But in each one of those instances, she's playing along with, the song pretty well. To some extent. Improvising a little. Somehow reaching into the Ganges and pulling somebody out, while she's also in a room 1,000 miles away. Giving darshan and that's just improvising, just doing a little bit of creative improvising, and that's all. But she's still singing the song in the basic format here of this world. Don't have to. I mean, Padmasambhava might just, you know, decide he is, I'm going to veer off here and sing another song. Turn into light. Go to the Copper Mountain. The Lotus Palace of the Diamond Light. Lotus Palace of Diamond Light in the Copper-Colored Mountain. This, you know, just diamond, referring to diamond mind. The diamond mind, which is my mind, is this diamond-like, diamond light mind. Lotus, the diamond light, lotus mind. So Padmasambhava did. He kind of went improvised a lot, actually, more than most, way more than most. So he would need to go somewhere. He'd just fly there, just locate. Just now I'm located over here. And so he's always doing these miracles, just amazing miracles. And then finally, just decided, okay, I'm gonna sing a different song right now. Just turn into all these pinwheels of beautiful light and just, yeah. So he went off script. He went off the song. He kind of went off the song there. And some saints go off, you know, improvise a little bit here and there, right? But yeah, it's not a problem. A little improvisation is good, isn't it? Kind of helps wake us up, realize, oh, I don't really have to go along with my belief that this is scripted, do you really? No, I don't have to do that. No, I can see that it's possible to, but it's tough to go off quote unquote script here in this world, because people expect it. You know, it's being imposed upon us, you know, by some dynamic. And if you go off script, you go, oh my gosh, God must have done a miracle for you, or you must have. How did you appeal to God to change the script for you? No, I just realized, God helped me realize there is no script. That's what happened. Not that God changed the script. God realized there is no script. So I can have it this way, or any which way, right now. So religion based on praying to God to change the script is totally delusional. Totally delusional, actually. It's very, very unhealthy to look at it that way. It's way better to you to ask God to help you see there is no script. Now the Holy Spirit will help you stay functional here on quote unquote script, what people expect of you. But at the same time, seeing that there really isn't any script, and if need be, you can improvise. Again, a good analogy is singing a song that you're really used to and improvising a bit on it. But most of the time, singing it pretty straight. Which is what I do when I sing. Yeah, I'll sing it straight for a while, and I'll decide to improvise, and I'll go back to singing it straight. And this is just naturally how I am here. And this is the way to be in the world, is to be able to improvise. You know, throw some miracles in there. But people are like really, makes them very nervous, because they're afraid, like, oh, I might go completely off script. You know, well, no, because you're not on a script. Nobody's on a script. They say, I might realize, you know, this is all pretense. Well, we'll gradually wake up to that, bit by bit. We need to get used to this. How are we doing? Pretty good. I've had troubles recently trying to tape, and the malfunctions and all sorts of stuff. Actually, usually around 107 it started to malfunction, so it's gone this far. But you never know, and suddenly the screen will go blank. It's like weird. Really troubles. But it's indications that I was getting pulled down. You know, we're really getting pulled down. There's an attempt to pull us down right now. And it's global. It's the script. See, if you understand what the danger is, then you'll say, aha, it's this global technology, which is all based on turning the machinery of the world, institutions, everything, turning it over to computers, which are run off of software, which are scripts. I can't write a lick of software. I've never been into writing scripts at all. I've never been into machines or technology or any of this stuff, a future. There's no technology in my future at all. There's no scripts in my future at all. Actually, there's no scripts right now. There's no scripts in anyone's future. There's never been any scripts. They don't exist. But we're just pretending that they exist. This is a funny thing. We're pretending we're being controlled by a script when in fact there is no script controlling us at all. None. So it's 100% pretense. And this is what we're afraid of, because we're afraid of stopping our pretense immediately. Like, it's scary. But who says that when we realize we're pretending, we have to stop pretending? That's a script too. That would be a script too, right? We don't have to stop pretending. We can keep pretending, but we can start improvising off the pretending. Like, say, yeah, I used to pretend like this, like I'm dead, but I'm going to improvise and decide I'm not dead now. And it's Jesus. He just improvised off of death. He said, yeah, okay, I'm going to go along with this song of death here, you know, because that's what you're all used to and stuff. And okay. But then he said, you know what? I think I'm going to improvise a little bit off of this and resurrect it from the dead. He didn't have to go to God and say, hey, God, yeah, I'm the script had me, and now I've scripted that I die and I'm dead. Could you change the script now and raise me from the dead? That's not how it happens. That's what we think happened. That's not at all what happened. God would say, what are you talking about? Jesus, I never scripted anything. I didn't script your death. I don't script anything. You're completely free. You just imagine it. You went along with, of course, Jesus knows this. I'm just saying this to clarify it. Just the absurdity of it. Jesus went along with our belief in what that we're scripted, and that death is the ultimate, you know, proof of this. And he said, oh, okay, I'll sing that song with you. Not a problem. And then he decided, now I'm going to improvise. I'm going to throw another verse in there. Don't sing it this way. Poof, resurrected. People said, what? I said, yeah, you could sing it that way if you want. In fact, feel free to. As a matter of fact, and if you believe in me and follow me, you'll be have eternal life right now, because you are eternal life right now, actually. There's only eternal life. That's all there is. Now, protecting our mind from insanity, which is the insanity of scriptedness, which is coming on like a freight train right now, with all of the software in the world running just about everything. They'll be able to shut down anything at all. If they want to, or cars. I think there's ways to shut down cars now, actually. The criminals are learning how to do that. In isolated places, they'll just kill the car. As a matter of fact, my vehicle shut down. All the electricity of the car shut down somehow. Nothing electrical worked. But the engine was still working. The combustion was still working. But all the electricity was just suddenly turned off. I was like, what? It's very, very eerie and weird. Very weird. And everyone I've talked to who are knowledgeable about mechanics, I haven't asked my mechanic yet, but other people, they say, what? How is that possible? That is really strange. But I restarted the vehicle and then it cleared up. I said, it's a computer thing then, isn't it? And I said, yeah, I mean, so it's possible, easily possible for your computer to shut off all electricity in your vehicle right now, right? It happened. It already happened to me. So don't think that computers can't shut anything down they want to shut down. They can shut down any machine they want to shut down, actually. It's all in the software. All the software has been coded in a certain way, which has back doors to it, various back doors, which the powers that be have insisted upon, actually. When you're doing any computer programming for the government and bureaucracy and these big corporations, etc., their software has back doors to it, which is, of course, NSA insisted upon this. Everybody did all this programming for their snooping. They insisted that these computer companies have back doors so they can spy on everybody, which they did and are doing. Well, there's also back doors to kill everything, too. It's power of the script, you know. So now, again, people might be wondering, well, the trouble's coming in, 2056 or 2000. The fact is, we are already there with all these software and all these scripts in the world. It's not 10 years away. It's already here, this right this instant, May 14th, it's our 15th, and you listen to this, it's already here. Let me see, is this the 13th? There's the 13th. This is the 13th. So it would be the 14th you're listening to this. Yeah, okay. That's right, because Tuesday's the 17th, which some say is the rapture. I don't know. It's possible. Because we understand what's going on now, don't we? I certainly am waking up to it. You don't want to get caught up in this belief in scriptedness. This is the devil. This is the devil of deceit, devil of conceit, devil of arrogance. We simply have made up qualities that don't exist. That's arrogance. Arrogance tells itself, I can't escape it. That's arrogance. It just made it up. It's not true at all. Arrogance just makes up whatever it wants to make up and claims it's true. That's pretending to be, a new prime creator. Just whatever we want to be true, that's true. If we want to say we're helpless or there's some external dynamic that's scripting us, we just claim, well, that's true because we believe in it. That's arrogance. It's not true. So we're really bogged down in this arrogance and conceit and think we can't do anything about it. Well, we can't go to a reduced intensity zone. How do we script that? What do you mean? You don't script it. You realize there's no script preventing it. It's when you realize there isn't any script at all preventing it that you say, oh, obviously I can do it. You don't have to try to find the script to do it. There is no script at all to anything, which is why we can do anything at all right now. So there are heavy indications going on right now, heavy synchronicities, conversations with people. Everything just keeps coming up that, wow, we're right there. We're right there. It's coming 2016. It's this year. And what I understand also today is understood by August 29th of this year, we may be out of here in some way, in some regard. I don't want to put into a scripted scenario exactly how a reduced intensity zone comes about. It could come about through a protection of our minds here. Actually, that's a possibility too, actually. I've already started to experience this. And no doubt we'll experience it more. So we're keeping the door open. That's a possibility. But it's coming real soon, which is why we're going forward and why we may be experiencing difficulties right now. I knew May would be very difficult. It's already been extremely difficult. Starting May is just brutally difficult. Wow. Starting April 26th, it started, didn't it? Yeah. And even prior to that, it was difficult. So we've had a run here of difficulty, and yet I've been able to keep my good habits going. They started to slip, but I caught it. Yeah, I said, "Uh-oh." My weight started going. I was like, shocking. I said, "What the heck is going on here?" And so I caught it, and I've been trying to push it back down. It's been a battle, to say the least. Without starving myself, it's pretty almost semi-starvation, trying to prevent, all the bad habits from creeping back in, because they're trying. Oh, take it easy. Oh, you don't need to exercise. Don't need to diet. You don't need to do this. Go look at the sports again. Oh, why not? All this kind of stuff is just, why not just, romanticize the world and say, well, no, there's this wonderful romantic script for the world. You know, this is, now there's no script, which is bliss, actually. I have the screensaver, which takes this folder of pictures of Ram Maharshi with quotes. And so I just sit there and look at the screensaver, and it keeps bringing up these new pictures with these quotes. And it's like nirvana. I mean, Ram Maharshi is so awesome. I just gratitude. I just, everything he says just strikes like lightning to me now. It's just, wow. It's exactly what he's saying. Just get rid of your thoughts, and the pristine state is there. He says, reality is just a pristine state. That is yourself. The pristine, he calls it pristine state, spontaneous state, unscripted state. Our thoughts are just a delusion that there's some script taking place. He says, just drop all that junk, and that's it. It's that simple. It's extremely simple, he says. And I'm hearing that and saying, yeah, you're right. I'm getting that. This is absolutely... Wow, how simple he was! He was just giving us this pure, simple truth. You know, how difficult it's been for us to recognize what he's saying, but now I'm seeing it. Just like, ah, that's so wonderful. He tends to be the quote meister. I love it. It works with him. These different teachers have different qualities. Different Dharma kings have different qualities of effectiveness. I use them all. You know, I'm very ecumenical, and it helps, because if you get stuck somewhere, you go to another one, they'll help free you from that, and they all complement each other. They're very complementary of one another, actually. If I'm working with Jesus, which I do a lot, A Course in Miracles, and I get bogged down with the history of Christianity or something, I can shift over to Longchenpa, you know, and just the baggage isn't there. It's like, oh. So our Ram Maharshi is just, Ram Maharshi is always like just, you know, instant gratitude. You know, seeing him, it's just like instant gratitude. The benevolence, you know, that he radiates towards us, the kind benevolence, it's just such a gift. Such a gift to us. We've had enormous grace given to us in the 20th century. Just vast. And we're reaping the benefits of that right now, as a matter of fact. So have gratitude for all the massive effect of grace that God has poured out upon us to free us from this horrible devil of conceit, of scriptedness, of technological scriptedness, which, of course, God's aware that we're trying to wrap ourselves in this cocoon, imprison ourselves in this, and so he gave us massive grace in the 20th century, and is continuing to pour out grace upon us. So we're just saturated in grace. We're super fortunate right now. This is what I'd like you to understand. This dawned upon me today. It's like, oh my gosh, I'm succeeding. I'm going to be liberated due to the massive grace of God that we've had. Unprecedented, right? Just consider it. We've had such an amazing amount of grace, so many great teachers, and a couple of Dharma kings for sure, and others, you know, you could say could be Dharma kings as well, if you want to. And then A Course in Miracles came along in the 20th century. The 20th century was just mind-blowing for its grace. Ram Maharshi, Sri Sri Anandamayi, A Course in Miracles. You take those three. And then Tibetan Buddhism spreading throughout the land, out the world. Wow. Journey Beyond Words. It's all in the 20th century. I mean, I was alive when, you know, most of this was taking place. Ramana passed away just before, you know, prior to I was born. I think he passed away in 1950. I was born in 56. But Anandamayi Ma was still going strong at that time. Tibetan Buddhists were starting to spread in 1959, I think. They really, you know, started to really spread throughout the world. And then lived through all of that. And then A Course in Miracles came in 19, started being inscribed in 65 and came out in, what, 70, 74 or something like that. And published Was it 76? But it was, yeah, I guess technically 76 was published. And so Journey Beyond Words, 1994. All of this massive grace was it just been, I've been saturated by it, saturated by it. And Ramana Maharshi says that, that the very fact that you're able to focus on God, that is God's grace, actually. The very fact you're looking at my picture, you're looking at this, or you're paying attention, or whatever, that is God's grace. Absolutely, it is. So that means for me, it's like, wow, God's grace is very, very powerful and acting in me very powerfully, because I'm always able to focus on all this, focus in on it. And this is due to the grace that God has poured out through the Holy Spirit, through these Dharma kings, on our behalf. Ram Maharshi is here, Sri Sri Narayana Maha is here, and then Jesus has returned. Returned in May of 215. Longchenpa returned here in Eastern Spirit in November of 213, November 2nd. Third, number third, 213. This is powerful, 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 powerful grace. All of these know for sure, without any doubt or temptation, that there's no such thing. Reality is not scripted at all. We're absolutely free. All of them know this, and advocate our knowing of this. So we should expect this grace to do tremendous miracles for us, and indeed they are doing so. Now, they have different qualities, and I have these beautiful flower frames. They're just gorgeous. They're just so beautifully done. And I'm trying to put the different Dharma kings in these frames. I try, and Longchenpa, it just fits. It just works for him so well. It's just perfect. But then I try to put Sri Sri Narayana Maha in the frames. It never works. It doesn't look right. It just simply doesn't look right at all. And then I try to Ram Maharshi, and it looks terrible. I can't put you in these flower frames. No way. He looks best in just a black background, as does Sri Sri Narayana Maha. It's just a stark black background with a picture on a black background. It's just like, okay. I mean, but putting flowers around them, it doesn't work. And Jesus, it doesn't work. It just doesn't. But Longchenpa, my God, it works. It's just fabulous. It's just fabulous. It's amazing how profound it is, and it's like it's the diamond mine. It's like you feel like you're experiencing the diamond mine. And speaking of the diamond mine, I was praying to Longchenpa yesterday, and I said, "Okay, I'm ready for another miracle. I'm really putting my faith in believing that you have the grace of God in equal measure. You're a true Dharma king. You absolutely know there's no script, and so, and you're here to help out and to complement the other Dharma kings. So let me experience your grace, and let me put my faith in you, and so pray for a miracle." And the grace acts so quick now. It's astonishing, quite shocking. He's bringing this up-tempo-ness, okay, to the whole thing, which is good. Like on a basketball team, you might have some player who brings that up-tempo-ness, like a Steph Curry or something. It's just, well, the other guys, they have their thing, they do their thing, they complement one another. So Longchenpa has this up-tempo-ness, like, you want a miracle? Okay, 30 seconds, there it is. It's quick, it's fast, and it's profound. So I asked for a miracle, and right away I got an indication he's going to answer it. As soon as I prayed, I went through, went on an overpass on the freeway, and there's graffiti that said "ghost" on it. And I said, "Okay, ghost, what does that mean?" "Oh, I'm going to see an apparition of Longchenpa." I said, "Okay, great, I'm ready for it." So I thought that there's going to be an apparition appear, a vision of Longchenpa. Well, it didn't happen. I'm going to say, okay, I was looking for it, really intently looking. Okay, where's it going to happen? Because I really believe that Longchenpa would answer my prayer, and there's the indication there's going to be some sort of ghost apparition. So I said, that doesn't scare me. I'd love to see that. And then I got this internal vision in my mind's eye, not out there, but within, was Longchenpa in the guise of Vajrasattva, of the diamond mind. Or the lotus of the diamond light, the diamond light lotus. But it was like this, it was like a sort of an outline of a figure, but it was like diamond pendants, sort of just sending out this beautiful shimmering diamond light. And this appeared to me in my mind's eye. And I recognized this is the Vajrasattva, Sambhogakaya appearance of Longchenpa. You know, I have enough understanding of Tibetan Buddhism to recognize it. I said, wow. I was like, and I just was looking at it. I was driving, but I was seeing it internally at the same time. It didn't interfere with my driving. Just gently, subtly, here it was. And didn't wordless, didn't say a word. Doesn't need to. That was the whole thing. Absolutely quiet. Still, calm, peaceful, beautiful, sublime, benevolent, all benevolent. And he was just showing this to me, the diamond mind to me. I said, this is how I look at Sambhogakaya. The figurine you're using is Nirmanakaya, which is the bodily appearance, the body of grace appearing. And that's very profound, because you can see, you can feel the stillness, the absolute unscriptedness of his mind, which is just no thoughts, no words, no concepts, no need for any of that. Absolute safety and perfection and abidance, just perfect. You can feel that. I can, in this, that golden figurine I use, in these pictures I use, the golden statue of Longchenpa. But he was showing me this more living lightness of the Sambhogakaya, which is the bliss body. Tibetan Buddhism has this trinity of bodies, Dharmakaya, Sambhogakaya, Nirmanakaya. Kaya means body. And the Sambhogakaya is the bliss body, which is more subtle. And it's so sublime. It's so beautiful. It's like draped, like dewdrops, diamond dewdrops are just streaming. It's just streaming in diamond-like light. You know, it's just, and so utterly equipoise, such absolute beyond poise, poise beyond poise, effortless poise, effortless simplicity, effortless abidance, just beyond even effortless, just presence, pure presence, pure presence. So that's what Longchenpa gave me as the miracle. I wasn't even expecting that. I was like, wow, that's way better than apparition. Because apparition would be more like a Nirmanakaya appearance of a body, external body. But no, this was the internal Sambhogakaya body of Longchenpa. He showed it to me. Which came a couple days after I had this experience. When I went to bed, I lay my head against the pillow, and suddenly I experienced as if this lotus flower suddenly grew up from the muddy earth, suddenly grew up, you know, on its stalk, kind of beautiful, winding, gracefully undulating stalk came up, and this lotus blossom then just opened up right in front of me. And it was just this diamond light, beautiful diamonds light, just shining this beautiful clear light. And wherever I looked, my attention went, this diamond light then ornamented where I was looking. Just this exquisitely beautiful, sublime ornamentation of everything. Everything was just so sublime. And I moved my attention somewhere else in my mind's eye. That too was just bejeweled. Everything was bejeweled, like with dewdrops of exquisite beauty. And creativity and ornamentation is just like awesome, awesomely sublime. And I just said, wow, okay, that's why they use the lotus flower, or the cobra with a hooded cobra opening up. There's just different ways to symbolize it. It is this, you know, it's just this beautiful living flower comes up from the mud of the dirt and opens up this clear diamond light. and you realize this is true mind. This is my mind. This is the real mind. This is our true mind. It's like this. Needless to say, I was like, wow. So, getting these experiences, which are designed to protect our mind from this, you know, this terrible scourge of scriptedness in the world. I've always hated scriptedness. I guess why I dropped out of school in seventh grade. I just decided I can't handle this anymore. This is going to kill me. I mean, this is going to, you know, this is terrible. And I kept going, but my mind wasn't there anymore. I just stopped paying any attention in seventh grade. Never paid any more attention to school. I made it through high school somehow, flunking a bunch of classes, but I was in advanced classes. They couldn't flunk me, but I paid no attention. Like the chemistry and physics, I paid no attention. I just put my head down and would, you know, think about non-dual truth and stuff. It's just the great saints and sages. And then I went to 1 year of college, and I was so sick of the scriptedness that then I couldn't function anymore. There's just no way I could go any further, you know. And of course, I let everybody down. They thought, oh, you're so smart. You could have a great, you know, you got to go to college. In my social class, everybody went to college. You had to drop out was horrible, was terrible, was unthinkable. To not make it through, everybody I knew went through 4 years of college. Everybody. So I was like the pariah, you know, someone who just couldn't make it. It was like nobody even talked about it. But I dropped out. They didn't know I dropped out of school in seventh grade. I said, this is ridiculous. This scriptedness. We're just going into the hell of script of false belief in scriptedness. So I turned my education over to the Holy Spirit in seventh grade. How old was I then? Like 12 or so. Yeah, so I've been 46 years or something. Or how many? Yeah. I don't know. What is this? I can't even add right now. That's how unscripted I am. yeah. I think it's 48 years. About 48 years. I've been 48, full blast, Holy Spirit education to get free of the belief in scriptedness. And of course, nobody, you know, very few, nobody I know personally, you know, here that understands it. Oh, what are you talking about? No, reality's not scripted. I can't even say such a thing as they're clueless, spiritually illiterate. That's what happens. I realize if I go through this education, I'll be spiritually illiterate at the end of it. I said, it's not worth it. Now, of course, I ended up not having a livelihood, so I end up picking up garbage, you know. But people respect that. They realize, wow, that's not an easy thing to do, you know. Wow. Poor guy. They pity me. But that's okay. I'm having visions of Nangchenpa Sambhogakaya, diamond mind, you know, as I'm picking up garbage. Right. Yeah, that's true. I clean up sites and stuff, picking up all the junk and stuff and garbage. Part of what I do, and people must think I'm just, you know, the lowest of the low. But no, I'm getting miracles from Longchenpa while I'm doing that, because if I got a college education, I'd be, you know, an academic or something, and maybe getting tenured, and you know, I'd be Mr. Expert on something, and I'd be completely spiritually literate, you know, wouldn't have a clue. I'd be walking my dog somewhere, you know. Yeah. That's what I saw, some guy like my age, and he's a nice, you can see he's a professional, a very successful professional, and his slacks, a nice long sleeve button shirt, and he's nice shoes, and nice clean cut, and he's, I said, what are you doing? I said, what's he doing? Oh, I saw he's holding something. It's a leash, and his dog's off in the bushes somewhere, you know, he's waiting for his dog, and this is what he does. They walk their dogs. They're spiritually illiterate. All they know how to do is walk their dogs. It's the worst illiteracy there is. It's way, I know lots, I don't know, I know people who are academically illiterate. They can't read or write, but they're very bright, smart, very capable. They can do all the work, you know, really talented, do all sorts of manual work, various types of work that don't require reading or writing. They can do basic arithmetic as far as measuring and stuff, but they can't read or write really. Right? They weren't taught that. And very bright. So, but in the, by fifth grade, I didn't need school anymore at all. That's a fact. I knew how to read and write and arithmetic, and I was a whiz at all of it. And it was okay, it was easy. It's not a problem. That's it. I don't need more. That's it. I didn't even. But so you can function with reading without reading and writing and arithmetic skills. But to be spiritually illiterate is a disaster for you. It's a disaster because you're going to get sucked into the scriptedness. And some of these people, they know it. They say, "Hey, wait a minute." I'm getting this all the time. They say, "Hey, I did this happened here, this happened here." And they're going, they're putting two and two together. They may be illiterate, but they're very bright. And they say, "I think there's like some sort of, you know, script that is like coming in, this like going to get us all." And they're aware of it. These are people that are not, we wouldn't say, are that, you know, oh, they didn't have any schooling, but they're not all screwed up by the schooling, and they can kind of see a trap more easily than we can see it. And so they see it. I see it like a trap coming here. They really, I say, yeah, I see it too. There's no question about it. So spiritual illiteracy is the disaster in this planet, because you don't know how to get free of the scriptedness. Then you see, you don't know how to get free of it. So when they ask you, "Help, help, help," I explain it to them. They think, "What are you talking about? I have no idea what you're talking about. You're just talking a foreign language to me." Well, that's called illiteracy. So we should raise our children from the get-go in spiritual literacy. And there's some cultures that do that. For instance, the Jews have done this for a long time. Is the, I mean, the first thing they teach their kids is spiritual literacy of Judaism. And you know, other cultures have done that too. The Indian Kali culture of India would, you know, you brought up to, and Christianity has done that. That they bring the children up, you know, first thing they read is the Bible, or they study scripture, and they study, you know, various things, and they become somewhat spiritually literate to some extent. But you know, the non-dual literacy is what you need to be literate about, actually. And some Indians are literate about it. You can tell they were raised that way. They don't really get it, but you can at least converse with them, and they pretend like they have it, they get it, because they're literate about this. They're familiar with it. But this is sometimes a problem you run into with those who are literate in that way, is they think they understand because they were brought up with these words and terminologies, but they don't really practice it and get it. They haven't really, you know, it's like just recognition of the words. So then they say, "Oh yeah, okay, yeah, of course I understand what you're saying. I can't get, you know, 'cause," but no, they don't. That's a problem. That's a. But you know, just because it's that there's that potential problem, at least they feel comfortable enough to converse, you see, and put themselves in a situation where they can benefit. So that's someone would go to Ram Maharshi and say, "Yeah, I understand," and this is, but they really didn't. But then they say, "Well," then they catch something and say, "Wait a minute, that's sort of like what the non-dual thing I thought I understood. That's actually what it's pointing to. Oh wow." You know, like that. Oh, I didn't realize it actually was pointing to that. It was just a pointer. Oh my gosh. But then they have a way to refer to it, and you know, so it's helpful. It's very helpful. It's very, very helpful and necessary, actually. Otherwise, what can anyone do to help you, help out, right? Help anyone. If they're spiritually illiterate, they'll feel like they're being attacked by someone's jabbering at them in some language they don't understand. And you know, they're just like, Oh, they're crazy. Get away from me. You're crazy. Get away from me. You're crazy. That's the thing. I try to help people and try to talk non-dual to them. They suddenly get all freaked out. They get all freaked out. This guy's trying to attack me. I say, no. I'm just, aren't you spiritually literate? Like, what are you talking about? I said, well, folks, how can I help anyone if you're spiritually literate? That's ridiculous. You got familiarity. So civilization, if it wants to avoid going really down the tubes, down the toilet, has to be very spiritually literate and enough to recognize the sinful nature of our arrogance. That this is all just arrogance, a play of arrogance. Now, we're far enough along where Jesus could come along and explain the etiology of our situation here, which wasn't explained by Buddhism or Advaita Vedanta previously. I guess it was too shocking for people really to be really brought out in the open, but they called it some, adventitious defilements or something came, or some defilements or adventitious chance clouds or something, clouded over. No, that's not true. It was absolute. Nothing happens just by chance. Yes, see, the whole that's denying the nature of reality. Say, a chance occurrence of this. There's no chance or luck involved in reality. Everything, whatever arises, is because we ask it to, desire it to. So we desired to be greater than God. That's arrogance. Okay. So this play of believing in scriptedness came about from our desire to be greater than God. It's plain and simple. It's arrogance. And so this is called original sin in Christianity, is arrogance, spiritual pride. This is the root of our troubles. And so to recognize this, that this is all pretense, and like, wow, I got a continuity problem then, and that nothing is scripted at all, and my belief in scriptedness is delusion. This is called repentance. They're called repentance. Wow, I've got a problem, because now I'm so used to believing in scriptedness. Wow, to get from my belief in scriptedness to accepting there's no script at all, this is quite a, you realize, wow, that's quite an undertaking. This is really a challenge. And then this is the true religious life, is to take up this challenge. It starts out with repentance, recognizing that this is all just arrogance. And then to drop all this arrogance, this requires, quite a focus and an intense determination. And who has that intense determination in the world? How many right now? Wow. Some, a few. The only sane culture is a repentant culture. Now, Christianity tried to repent, but they kind of did it like halfway. Halfway is no way at all, actually. Because they said, no, all this is scripted. It's just God scripted it all. Not us. God did it. Scripted it all. And therefore, God can change the script if we just appease God. And, this is not true. God didn't script any of this. Nandamayama would say, well, yeah, this is all God scripted. But what she meant, she said, well, what do you think? Did it? You? She meant the human, the belief in the ego. What she really meant was the mind, the one mind scripted all this. Which is true, but we asked the mind to do this. God didn't ask the mind to script, to believe. I'm sorry, not scripted it, but to believe, to pretend all this, to pretend that there's a script. God didn't say, "Hey, I want you to believe in a script." No, that would be completely opposite of God. God doesn't want us to believe in scriptedness. God wants us to believe in freedom. What she was getting at was that don't think that the human, quote-unquote, human mind did this. Look deeper and realize it's the one mind that is imagining all of this because we asked it to. And these emanations of the Holy Spirit, of the grace of God, are very difficult for us to understand, because they can't help but be aware that there's no scriptedness at all, and yet they are acting, pretending as if there is enough to kind of reassure us. So their answers are always playful in some way. And Sri Srinath, my mom, would say, I never said anything. She said, I never said anything, actually. What she was getting at was don't take anything to be a script. She said, you put all the words in my mouth, so to speak, meaning that it was your belief in scriptedness which brought out what I had to say to you, okay? But I was also playful with it in such a way that you could help you kind of like ease off of it. So you can't really pin down what she said very well at all. Sometimes it was more so than others, as you said, you have to go beyond good and bad consciousness to just see that all is just saturated isness, actually. But a lot was said in such a way that you can't really pin it down. and she often spoke to individuals just individually, like, this is just for you, this is how I'm playing, this is the play of sadhana with you, and the play of someone else is going to different, you know. And then people took, well, she said this to me, as if that's some sort of definitive statement or something. No, it's a play. It's all a play. But there's no ultimate script. It's just a play. It's improv. Spontaneous. And it's just all spontaneous improv. Okay, this is the way the Dharma kings are. It's just spontaneous improv. And she said, you have to get to the point where you realize there isn't any right answer to any question at all. Whereas I would say the answer to all questions is don't ask the question. Don't ask the questions. That's the answer. And she would say, there's multiple ways to answer any question. There isn't any one way to answer it, actually. Which is, you know, meaning, we're free. There's no script. How do I get free of a script that doesn't exist? Well, I mean, how are you going to respond to that? It's like this, and it's like this, and it's like this, and it's like this, and this, this, and this, and this, and this. Meaning, there isn't any script, really. Different ways to go about it. So we've covered a lot of territory here. It's getting a little late in the evening. I've been able to stay on point pretty much so here. Hasn't been easy. Last couple of weeks, last 3 weeks have been very, very brutally difficult. And probably will continue to be this way. But we already have the protection. Keep this in mind. We already have it. We already have refuge. We already have protection. We already have everything that we need to be entirely unaffected by what is to come in the world. And of course, we know that trying to get rid of the scripts, trying to get rid of all the software, the computers, all the chips, you know, it's not going to happen, is it? Unless there's some massive coronal mass ejection that fries all the electronics, which might be a nice help. Maybe that's going to happen too, you know, I don't know. But I think the Amish had a pretty good awareness. The Holy Spirit spoke to them and said, hey, you know, don't go down that road of technology, right? And so they decided not to. Pretty awesome. The Amish. It they decided to stick with the horse and buggy, which is very, very wise decision on their part. Very wise. Well, it's not a guarantee of anything that they're going to realize the unscriptedness of reality, but it certainly puts them in a good position to listen, you know, right? To experience it internally, if they choose to. But again, halfway is no way. Keep this in mind. Halfway is no way. Halfway is no way at all. You either believe in scriptedness or you don't. You can't believe in a little bit of scriptedness. That's scriptedness. If any of reality is scripted, then reality isn't real. And God isn't real. Any of it. So either you believe in that there's scripts, that reality is scripted, or you don't. There's no wiggle room. There's no like, well, it's partially scripted or a little bit is scripted. It's either you're pregnant or you're not. And so there's no middle ground at all. That's just the lie of the ego saying, well, there's some middle ground. That's just arrogance. It's just making this up out of thin air. There's no middle ground. Either all of reality is real or reality is not real at all, because the reality of reality is that all of it's real. That is reality. That there's only freedom. So if you say, well, there's some of reality that's not free, that's not reality anymore. You're not talking about reality anymore. You're talking about something else that doesn't exist. Okay? So the non-dual is just this absolutism, which is abstraction, absolutism. This is the key to it, is just to practice abstraction in your mind. Get used to abstraction. Now, as you have this vision of like Vajrasattva, the diamond mind, Christ mind, it's exactly the same principle, diamond lotus light mind. Our Holy Spirit dove mind, however you want to call it. As you abide with that, you begin to take on that quality. You do. It's by abiding with this inner vision, and it's silent. There's nothing that needs to be said, because it's absolute assurance beyond any words. Any word spoken would break this, you know, the awesomeness of it. They don't need to say anything. There's nothing they need to say. There's no script. And they're certain of it. So you feel their certainty. You feel the absolute assurance, effortless assurance. They're not trying to assure you. They simply are saturated with assurance. Like diamonds, wearing a diamond cap. Like a shower cap that is just all made of diamonds. The whole thing is just diamonds, beautiful diamonds. They're just streaming like a fountain of diamonds, just of clear light, diamond certainty, diamond-like certainty. It's even beyond certainty. And so we can directly experience this, actually. And just anytime we want to, we can look within and see this and experience this. It's there. It's there for us if we're willing to see it. It's just our own mind, actually. And so we can just like, oh. And then the nirmanakaya, or the body here, the appearance body, begins to look more and more like the sambhogakaya, or the bliss body. It begins to radiate, has subtle overtones, start echoing, and you look more and more blissful and assured and calm and peaceful and just diamond-like. So I looked in the mirror after this happened. I said, like, what? I was kind of like a little bit shocked. I said, wow, I look different. I noticed a very much of a difference. So you look at like Sri Sri Nandamayama or Rana Maharshi, look at their eyes, look at their countenance, and you just say, whoa, what are they looking at? What are they seeing? This is why I always ask myself, what is it are they seeing? They're obviously seeing something that's so beautiful It just lights them up. Now I know. It's just the inner. They're seeing the mind, the inner self. Ramana called the self. The diamond light, Vajrasattva Sambhogakaya, the Christ light, the Christ mind, Christ consciousness. They're seeing that. That's what they're saturated with it. Saturated with the isness. They're seeing it. They're aware of it. And we can too. It's there for everyone. All right, we hit the two-hour mark, didn't we? Okay. So, I'm probably moving towards wrapping it up here. So, we already have the protection. Just realize this. We already have it. And then go right into gratitude. Don't struggle. Go into the wow of gratitude. Wow. I'm already saved. Christians do this with Jesus, do they not? They say, I'm born again, I'm saved. Born again means they had an experience of the Sambhogakaya, the bliss body of Jesus, showing himself as the bliss body. And then they realize, oh my gosh, you know, that's me. I'm born again. It's not, I'm not the old body of flesh at all. Really. And then, so, and they have faith and gratitude that Jesus saves. I know I'm saved. Jesus has saved me. Meaning they feel he's already saved me. So it's a done deal. It's a done deal. So the Christians, some Christians are very advanced that maybe people don't realize that, or maybe they don't even realize that. Or maybe they don't even care. I don't know what. You know what? The scripted culture of the ego tries to portray Christians as a bunch of knuckleheads. They use the most knucklehead examples they can find and try to, you know, demonize all Christians. But at the root, Christianity is the same as the other religions in terms of, you know, this gratitude for what you've already received. That's the same in all religions. It's just the right practice. You know, it's just right practice. And I know the thinking mind hates to admit it, don't they? The scripted mind hates to admit that Christians could possibly be, you know, more advanced than them by the thinking, conceptual, scripted belief in script mind, academic mind, all this egoic mind. They think that's the ultimate, and the Christians are a bunch of idiots. They think that they're saying, "Oh, Jesus is saved. I'm already saved. Thank you, Jesus. I got so much gratitude for you. Thank you, Jesus. I have so much gratitude." Just feel the love and the gratitude towards Jesus. Absolutely, I absolutely do. I know it's fashionable to think that somehow Jesus is just inferior, you know, to... No, he's not. Read Journey Beyond Words. And that's just as powerful as Spaciousness, the Radical Exhaustion, the Vajra Heart by Longchamp. It's just as powerful. It's complementary. It's got some aspects that are a little different. You know, they're a little different in various ways. But each one is just as powerful, really. So Jesus doesn't take a backseat to anyone. But nor do I put him, you know, necessarily in the front seat, ahead of everyone either. Because there is no script. So where's their head and behind and, you know, what script is that? There's no script at all, really. But Jesus is absolutely tremendous teacher. Doesn't take a backseat to anyone. He teaches us exactly the truth. In a very beautiful, benevolent way. So, by all means, have gratitude towards Jesus, because Jesus has already saved you. You're already saved. There's no question about it. You can say the same about Longchampa, the same about Ramaharshi, the same about Sri Shinanamayama. They've already saved us for sure. Absolutely for sure. Because what are they but the grace of God? And the grace of God knows but one. That's all. Just the oneness of truth, of unscripted freedom. What else is there to know? What else is there to know? And of course, that's known right now, right? Since there isn't any script, it has to be known right now. It has to be present here right now. The grace of God has to be here right now. Because the grace of God knows just one, the oneness of perfect freedom, of no script at all. So where can no script be except right now? It has to be right now. Can't be anywhere else. There isn't anywhere else. There's nowhere else except for now. Right here, right now. There's nowhere else. So all grace is present with us right here, right now. So allow your mind to be protected. Allow this inner vision to arise. And for me, it just did spontaneously. I wasn't thinking about it at all. I never even thought of such a thing. I just, now I see where historically they get this idea of a lotus flower rising up, you know, and all, and the diamond light and all this kind of stuff. Because that's how they experience it. Inwardly, they had this experience spontaneously happening. And then they kind of looked for a way to artistically depict it. And they, you know, said, well, yeah, you know, I can use a lotus flower or whatever. I could see where they get it now. But I wasn't thinking of anything like that. It just happened spontaneously. It's like, wow. Huh. Great. So, just let this lotus flower of diamond light, just let it be there. Let it be there. You don't have to do anything about it. You don't have to capture it or grasp it or take a picture of it or anything like that. Just let it be there. Just let it stay there. You don't have to talk with it or anything. It's just the silence is just perfect reassurance. It's the protection. That is the protection. So let the Sambhogakaya just be present within your awareness. That's what's needed. And ultimately that protects us so we'll realize the Dharmakaya, or the form, absolute freedom from all form, all even, you know, any even remote belief or inference of form, the ultimate Dharmakaya. That protects us so we ultimately, you know, can reach that. So, as Jesus says, healed perception is as far as we can really go pragmatically here, which is the Sambhogakaya, actually. So just allow that healed perception to vision of oneness, vision of holy instant, and Horse of Miracles, holy instant, vision of Christ, vision of oneness. Allow that to be present. Just be present. That's all with you. In the now, you just it's there. That's what you see in the now. You don't have to be academic about it at all. It's just pure reassurance, that's all. Effortless reassurance. Effortless, just absolute benevolence is just present there. Just this speechless, wordless benevolence, which is really assuring us that, yeah, reality is unscripted. That's what it's really telling us. So how can it have a script to give us? It doesn't. It is present, script-free there for us. So when we might freak out and say, okay, well, where's the script? Okay, I'm not getting the script. No, they're not giving us any script. So this is our reaction, isn't it? We think, okay, this is great, oh, so wonderful. And then we start thinking, okay, but I'm not getting like a transmission of a script. There's no channeling. I'm not getting words. I'm not hearing anything. Well, you know, okay, so what am I missing? Okay, and then you start looking around at, you know, to see, you know, well, what am I missing? And then we we lose sight of contact with it, sort of. It disappears, like the fog of words and concepts occlude it, you know. And so just don't realize there is no script. That's the whole point of it. So you're not missing anything. We're not missing anything. And so when we realize that, then the vision won't be occluded. It will be present. I was up on this mountaintop and all the fog was streaming over the mountaintop. Down the valley below, it wasn't cloudy, but up on the mountaintop it was. And suddenly the fog thinned out and I saw this whole, like a vision, the whole valley there was suddenly like, what is that? And then the fog really lifted for a moment. The wind came up and it lifted. And just like that, the whole massive Bay Area was suddenly crystal clear in front of me. I jumped out of nowhere. And then the fog came back and it disappeared again. And then the wind came up and it suddenly was there again. And that went, I experienced that like a bunch of times. And it was very powerful, extremely powerful experience. I said, wow, that's just like the now. You know, our thoughts occlude it because we're looking for a script. We say, okay, well, what's the, okay, I'm not hearing the script, so let me, maybe it's like this. And we start thinking, okay, well, what's the script? Maybe I need to generate one, generate some conversation, a script. That occludes the vision of the Sambhogakaya, the holy instant and the now of God's grace, which is reassurance that there is no script. Reality's not scripted, so we're not missing anything. We're fine. Everything's perfect. Just let that awareness just be there. Wordlessly be there. And just your reaction, just gratitude. Just thank it for being there. It's already there, as a matter of fact. The more you have gratitude, the more you thank it, the more the fog lifts and you'll see it. You'll see it. This is the vision of Christ, right? That the Course of Miracles talks about. And of course, other traditions have seen the same. It's just Buddha mind. Is what it is. They've seen the same, but they use different labels. But Buddha, I mean, natural mind, natural awareness mind. The mind of natural awareness, Buddha, I mean, natural awareness, natural being, mind. Natural being, mind. You see it. Many have seen it throughout history. Many have seen it. Some have abided it, allowed it to just remain there. And then they begin to take on this Sambhogakaya quality of the Christ consciousness, they call it. Christ consciousness. Some call, you know, that's a label. Christ consciousness. The diamond-like consciousness. Diamond mind. They take on this quality. And then people say, oh, you're like a saint. You know, you're different. You're not like this fleshy kind of person. Or, you know, it's like, so obviously there's something really, you're seeing something sublime, you know. Well, it's there to be seen. I've glimpsed it. I really saw it yesterday. I was just like, wow. I was so grateful. I said, thank you so much. I'm so grateful, Longchamp. Thank you so much for showing me your Sambhogakaya like that. The fog just lifted. The fog lifted. Now, when the fog was streaming on the mountaintop, it was still beautiful. I mean, the whole ambience of the near hillside, I could see it in the fog and everything. It was like beautiful. But when it lifted, oh my gosh, you know, you saw the entire Bay Area. The bay, the water, shining light, and then all the greenery and houses and structure and just the whole milieu of the Bay Area, you know. It was like, wow, just jumped out. Whoa. Suddenly. It's the, just a boom. How cool is that? And on the edges of it, the mist was still there. At the edges of it, it was like a vignette. It was vignetted with the mist, and yet the middle was all clear. This is like very similar to seeing the Sambhogakaya, a vision of Vajrasattva, a vision of Christ. Is it's still vignetted in words and concepts, and yet the whole middle area is just all clear. The concreteness of belief and script drops away. I had a dream like that where this huge concrete block, I was drilling holes in it and trying to get rid of it, and suddenly all of it, the whole middle just disappeared. It was all gone. So, but the edges were still there. The edges were still there, which means there's some referencing. Still, okay, some referencing of script, just little tiny edges, but the whole center of it just was all clear, completely clear. There's the vision of Sambhogakaya, vision of Christ. This protects our mind from the hideousness that is going to be upon us soon. Anyone who's abiding in the vision of Christ, the vision of Vajrasattva, Sambhogakaya, they're very helpful to help calm others down, actually. People just feel this, for some reason, I don't need to worry. Everything's going to be okay. Everything's okay. Not many people could worry when they're around Ram Maharshi, you know that? They might come to him worrying, but before you know it, the worry's gone. They just, I just don't feel like I need to worry anymore. Everything's going to be fine. Everything's fine. Everything's just, it's going to be just perfect for me. As Ramana said, it all turns out, it's all perfect in the end, so just don't worry. Everything will turn out perfect for you. And, of course, everything is perfect right now, if we just would see it, that we're perfectly in control of our experiencing, really. So, you know, gratitude, all gratitude to the Dharma kings and the Sambhogakaya nature that they're very aware of, and they will show this to us. I used to see in Sri Sri Narayana that way too. I wasn't quite sure what was going on. It was so powerful. And I couldn't quite put it in context, actually. I knew it was the grace of God, but I didn't have this overall context, and it was easy for me to get knocked out by religionists, you know. I mean, all these religions have religionists, right? Gradualists who believe in scriptedness to such an extent they become dogmatic. You know, they can occlude your vision of the Sambhogakaya vision, just be all their questions and demanding you describe it. Is it real? Or is it, you know, they get all academic on you and all this, you know, they get all egoic on you. And this is tough to deal with, to say the least. These Dharma kings can deal with that. They know how to deal with it. And we can too. We just stay abiding in it. Some of you are getting this. I'm getting it too. We're getting it together, sort of. It's coming quickly now. And as the Christians say, Maranatha, come quickly, Jesus. Maranatha, come quickly. Let's see your Sambhogakaya right now. Yeah, we need it. We need it now. But Jesus says, well, it's here, right? It's already here. What are you talking about? He says, you need to abide in it, you know, right now. And realize there is no script to get. So when people ask you questions, the answer to the question is don't ask the question. Because they're really saying, well, how can I abide? You know, what's the answer? What's the secret? There's no secret, except it just there's no script. So it's just silence. Silent. They're just silent. Sambhogakaya is silent. Now, what is this? Jesus transmitting A Course in Miracles and Journey Beyond Words. That's the Nirmanakaya, more the Nirmanakaya principle of, in my opinion, this is how I see it. It is, that's more of an appearance body thing, okay? But the Sambhogakaya, I believe, is silent. And the Dharmakaya is completely beyond anything we can say whatsoever, you know, even can't even say silent about it. And we need not worry about that. But let's just say the Sambhogakaya, Holy Innocent, is silent. It's silent. It's absolutely silent. It's still. As Rama says, it's saying everything. It's saying, I'm completely free. I'm completely unscripted. Therefore, all experiences are present for me right now. Equally, really. I mean, there's nothing I need to say at all. There's no script. I don't need to write any script at all. I'm totally free of that. And it's just radiating this assurance to you. Doesn't need to say anything. So you don't need to worry like, what do I need to channel? You know, this whole thing about channeling. Not everybody is called to channel. A few are. But that doesn't mean they're like more advanced than you and I. Not necessarily at all. That's dealing with the Nirmanakaya principle. And maybe they're adept at that. And they are. They do a good job of it. But we need not do that. We need not do that. We need not do that at all. We may just allow the Sambhogakaya Christ consciousness to just dwell with us. Just dwell, silently dwell with us. And just be present. And this really transforms us to an extraordinary extent, more than any words could transform us, actually. It's way more transformative than any words, which is the gift Longchenpa gave me. He said, okay, you're ready to go beyond the words, my words. You're ready to go beyond words. Here's my gift to you. From all the study you did, all the application you've done, here's my Sambhogakaya appearance now. No words at all. And truly, there's no words that come up. It's just gratitude comes up. That's all that the reaction just comes up. It's just gratitude. Because it's just reassurance. It's pure reassurance that there's no script. Reality has no script. Pure reassurance. So what needs to be scripted? We don't. No, it's just gratitude. Gratitude really doesn't need to be scripted, does it? No. It sort of feels pure to us, doesn't it? So just practice this gratitude and be willing to have these miracles. Longchenpa is, again, he's playing up-tempo style, fast-breaking up-tempo style. So you ask for miracles, he'll bring them quick to you. He's not, it's just like shockingly quick. I've been blown away by it. It's so amazing. I was like, oh my gosh. 30 seconds, boom, there it is. I'm used to thinking like a couple days or something. Now it's like Longchenpa, 30 seconds. And who knows, maybe we may be headed towards like 1 second. Right, but 30 seconds is a nice start. Picking up the tempo here. Got to pick up the tempo. I'm a little bit like, I get kind of a little nervous, or not nervous, but I kind of like, should I really pray to Longchenpa, because I know I'm going to get an answer really fast. Am I really ready for the answer for a miracle that quickly? I ask myself this. And when I can finally get my nerve up, I say, okay, yes. And you can, when you relax into that, say, okay, just yes, okay. I'm ready. And so I know it's going to come. So just go into gratitude and the wowness. Just be prepared for the wowness and gratitude. It's already done. As soon as we ask, it's done. Like ordering ice cream. Once you order, they're going to bring you the ice cream. So why not start feeling gratitude? Say, oh, the ice cream is going to taste so great, and I'm so happy I'm going to have that great taste of ice cream. And start feeling gratitude right now instead of saying, wow, am I going to get the ice cream? I'm not sure I'm going to get the ice cream. How come they're taking so long? All freaked out and nervous and stuff. Some people are like that. You're right. And sometimes we're like that, right? And we say, relax, it's coming. You start getting in the ambience of realizing, wow, I got this gift coming too. I'm really going to enjoy it. And I shouldn't be speaking of ice cream because now I'm thinking about it. that's a no-no for me. Today is like smoothies pretty much. I did have just a real light salad with some feta cheese and a little few pecans. But the morning was just... was it coconut water, or is it just chocolate protein drink and some sort of cherry juice, baby, and chocolate protein powder, and it was a smoothie. And then I just did another one tonight. It was just cherry juice, tart red cherry juice, chocolate protein powder and a chocolate protein drink, and blueberries, just blueberries. Blueberries and tart red cherry juice and a little bit of, I think, chocolate whey powder. I think that's what it was. That's my, you know, that's my food today. That's it. Trying to keep off the weight is crazy. But I realize that having this really problem, you know, it's a blessing in disguise. As Sri Srinanda, my mom, I always used to say this, that God gives you these sufferings, grace gives you these sufferings, but to help discipline your mind, it's a positive. And I realized that I have to have such discipline to not just blow up like a blimp. It's intense discipline every day. This helps me be super disciplined in my mind. So I become this very disciplined, determined person, you know, mindset, which helps me spiritually. It's actually a blessing in disguise. If I could just eat anything I wanted to, I'd just be pigging out, you know. I'd have no undisciplined. But I can't hardly eat anything. And people go to a place, they have all this pizza and pasta and all this free foods. Oh, free Harry, come on. Have some. Everybody's saying, come on, you can have some. And I said, no, I better not, you know, thanks, I better not. And they, no, come on, you can have. And I just walk out of there, and I don't have any. And people are saying, wow. They said, wow, you're really disciplined. People tell me that. I said, like, wow, you sure are disciplined, man. You got a lot of will. And I say, yeah, it's true, I do, because I got to be, really. I mean, I don't like being, you know, just, you know, obese and overweight and stuff. I can gain weight faster, and I could win the world championship and gain how fast I can gain weight. It's really, it's just insane. It's scary. So I just have to, you know, starve myself, basically. I always feel like I'm starving, which isn't very much fun, really, but it requires this really determination and discipline. Every day. See, food thing is every day, three times a day, maybe five times a day. What am I going to eat? Oh, it's the smoothie again. Okay, blueberries. That's what I pretty eat, frozen blueberries and strawberries, which strawberries, you know, you got to be careful. You got to, like, have strawberries frozen. It's better if they're frozen. And you drink the smoothie quickly, because if you just do regular room temperature strawberries and then don't drink the smoothie quickly, it starts fermenting on you very fast. Really, really, really. These fruits can really ferment fast. And then that smoothie doesn't taste so good anymore. I run into that all the time. So I'm starving right now. I mean, I eat at like 5 o'clock, and it's like, almost, it's midnight now. Yeah, it's 12:30, as a matter of fact. But, you know, I can't eat before I go. Maybe I'll drink a little bit of that smoothie, but that's it, you know. So I'll wake up tomorrow, I'll be starving, but I'll get on the scale, and it'll probably show I've gained weight, you know. This is the way it goes. The less I eat, the more I keep gaining. But, you know, maybe it'll be down a little bit. I don't know. It's just brutal. Brutal. And yet, it helps build this determination, doesn't it? And discipline, daily discipline. So, it's a blessing. God uses a thorn to remove a thorn that's in you. The thorn sticking in you, and then uses another thorn to get out that thorn that's in you. This is how it goes, right? And so you look at your life and say, well, there's a lot of blessings in my life. Blessings in disguise, maybe. Maybe these problems I have are actually forcing me to be very disciplined. Then I can apply that to what? Abidance. No script. Sambhogakaya, holy instant, Christ consciousness, Christ light, vision of oneness. It's all the same. It's this beautiful, beautiful presence of reassurance that reality has no script. And it's beautiful. I mean, it's just dripping with diamonds, like, I mean, just like diamond like. Wow. At least that's how it appeared to be. It's so beautiful with tinges of gold and just. I mean, it flows, you know. It's living. It's just living. It's not just an image. It's alive. It's living. The living light. of creativity, of our mind. So just start to feel gratitude for that which you are about to receive. See it? Jesus said, you know, blessed are those who believe without seeing. So doubting Thomas said, I won't believe you until I actually touch the wounds. But Jesus said, the scars, Jesus said, well, blessed are those who believe without seeing. You know, in other words, the ones who have faith and gratitude that it's there, already there, they're the ones that are going to see it then. They're the ones that are going to be blessed. Instead of the ones that say, well, I'll believe it when I see it. Jesus says, you'll see it when you believe it. So when you believe that Sambhogakaya, the diamond light, the lotus light of the lotus diamond light mind is there, when you have gratitude, you realize, yeah, I know it's already there, and so I'm just going to be so thankful it's there, and have that attitude, that's what then enables you to actually see it. Otherwise, you're still working on a script. What kind of script do I need to, you know, to match its script? I need to match its script. I need to understand its script. What's it going to say to me? You know, it's not going to say anything to you, okay? And it's not going to say anything to you. Keep that in mind. It won't say a word to you. But it knows that it's presenting itself to you and that you're seeing it. It is presenting itself to you. This is what I felt. It's saying, here I am. You know, like that. This is true mind. This is Buddha mind.